Hi, YouTube friends. Glad that you've become part of our community through the magic of the interwebs. So glad that you've come to join us. I want to give you a quick overview of what's happening on our online worship for February, the rest of February. February 11th is our youth leading service. There's a video of their service about the Super Bowl of Caring. February 18th, you'll see a video of sermon and scripture about the calling on people, how God calls people into particular forms of service and how we can help each other find that place where our deep joy meets the world's great hunger. And then on February 25th, you will see the first Sunday of Lent when we begin our series for Lent called For the Beauty of the Earth. We have this beautiful devotional book that has different reflections that you can look at each day about the earth care and how we care for God's creation, that gift to us. If you'd like to have a copy of this book, you can send us an email at firstpresbyteriansterling@live.com, or you can leave a message on our voicemail, or you can drop us a note on our Facebook page and we will send you one. We'd be happy to provide one of those books for you if you'd like to have a Lenten devotional guide. We will be doing, I gotta look at my notes here. We will be focusing each week on a different aspect of the created order, on the earth and the skies and the rivers and the oceans and streams and trees and plants and animals and birds and human life, and all of creation together, because we believe in the Presbyterian Church that we are stewards of the earth. We are charged with caring for this earth that God loves, right down from the smallest seed or insect to the biggest tree in the forest. So, and we confess, we haven't always done so. So we're going to be exploring some of that this Lenten season. Easter this year is on March 31st, but you'll be seeing the Easter service the following Sunday, which will be the first Sunday in April. So I hope you'll join us for all the Sundays in February and all the Sundays in March as we begin to move closer toward that celebration of new life and resurrection. Thanks for coming. And remember, you are loved and you are worthy and you are enough. Yeah.
Now, in that mythological story, God has despaired of humankind and sees no other recourse but a complete do-over, a cleansing flood to wipe it all out and start over. Those of you who studied the Gilgamesh epic in college will recognize this story from that. So God tells Noah in the story to build an ark and to save a pair of every species, and it rains for 40 days and 40 nights, and then God dries up the land, and Noah's family and all the animals begin to populate the earth anew. And then God speaks to Noah with these words of creation promise in Genesis 9, 8 through 17. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." Our second reading comes from the Psalms. As we reflect on God's covenant with every living thing, we turn to poetry and imagine the entire creation singing praise to God. Listen to these words from Psalm 148, verses 1 through 6, the Common English Bible. "Praise the Lord from heaven. Praise God on the heights. Praise God, all of you who are God's messengers. Praise God, all of you who comprise God's heavenly forces. Sun and moon, praise God. All of you bright stars, praise God. You highest heavens, praise God. Do the same, you waters that are above the sky. Let all of these praise the Lord's name, because God gave the command, and they were created. God set them in place, always and forever. God made a law that will not be broken." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. When the voice of God sounded, every living thing turned to listen. The birds in the trees cocked their feathered heads and turned bright little eyes toward the sound. It was the song of a nightingale, the warbling of a meadowlark. Mice and voles and prairie dogs listened too. They heard the tiny chitter in the dark silence of their burrows. Deer turned their heads, intent on the sound, alert and gentle. Fish heard the melody of the river. The whale paused in its journey to hear its own Leviathan song. The elephant and the snow leopard heard the low, dark rumble in God's throat. Dogs lifted noble heads, ears pricked, listening for the voice of the master. Cats turned in their naps, opening heavy eyelids in response to that deep, throaty purr. The busy insects stopped in their journeys to hear the click and buzz. Sheep ceased their grazing, cattle stood quietly, even the rivers and trees seemed to be attending. The humans, most of all, took notice. Every living thing was listening, for God was speaking. And this is what God said, "I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the animals, and every animal of the earth with you, I establish my covenant with you. God's voice echoed within them and drew their gazes to the heavens, to the clouds from whence the rains had come. Every living thing waited, holding its breath. There had been so much water, water everywhere. Now at last they stood on dry land, the good earth. And now that same water was droplets, suspended in the clouds, reflecting the brilliant sun in the spectrum of God's promise of mercy. A bow in the sky, no longer a weapon, but a sign of hope. A promise to every living thing on the earth. Earth is the stuff of life, we were reminded on Ash Wednesday, that we came from dust and we return to dust. That dust is not just soil, but stardust, the same dust that exploded into the cosmos to form the whirling planets and the sparkling stars. When we speak of the beauty of the earth, the beauty of the skies, we speak not only of the planet Earth, but the dirt beneath our feet on which we stand, from which we come, the earth that sustains us. This covenant from God asks us to be grounded in God's good creation, and also to be ever aware of the height and breadth of God's transcendent glory. To be grounded, literally, on the ground, is to be aware of how we can use land more responsibly. In the small local environment, that may mean organic gardening. It may mean choosing native plantings or the thoughtful placement of trees. It may mean the use of permeable pavement so that water reaches the ground. In the larger picture, it means thoughtfully and prayerfully considering how land is used, not only by us, but by those around us. Sustainable farming practices, for example, preserve and protect the land. Now, I've never met a family farmer who did not care about land stewardship. Factory farming, on the other hand, acquires and exploits massive amounts of land with a primary focus on maximizing profits. Take corn and beef, for example, commodities with which we are all familiar around here. Independent family farms once raised both crops and livestock, growing feed and grain for their animals, selling the excess grain, and then selling the livestock for breeding or for meat. Their operations and others like them supported co-ops, feed stores, implement dealers, truck sales, local packing houses, sale barns, and regional trucking firms. And that meant that local retail stores and schools and hospitals could thrive. Enter the factory farm. Concentrated animal feeding operations. There's even an acronym for it, CAFO, Concentrated Animal Feeding Operations. According to an article a few years ago in The Guardian, here's what they say. In these industrial farming units, pigs, cows, and chickens are crammed by the thousands into rows of barns. Many units are semi-automated with feeding run by computer and the animals watched by video with periodic visits by workers who drive between several operations. As factory farms spread, their demands dictated the workings of slaughterhouses. Smaller packing houses, which offer choice and competitive prices to family farmers, disappeared, to be replaced by huge operations that were further away and imposed lower prices on small-scale breeders. Their buying power helps drive farmers' decisions about which crops to grow. With no livestock, farmers were forced into growing corn and soybeans to sell to factory farms as animal feed, or to corporations for ethanol, end quote. The end result of this is visible in the grocery store and in our diets. We may have access to lower cost meat, but at what cost to us? Production of ethanol may be the future of alternative fuel, but it may also end up being a massive corn disposal program. Now, none of us alone can have much influence on factory farming, but all of us can make personal decisions about what products we buy and who we vote for and how we talk to our elected leaders about land use and farm policy and the stewardship of fragile ecosystems. As Margaret Mead famously observed, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has. There are many more examples of how we can ground our faith in action. It can be as small as giving up single-use plastics and paper towels, reusing and recycling, being mindful of packaging. Our choices can reduce the amount of trash that ends up in landfills. You know, some of what we throw away goes to a landfill and stays there permanently. Materials like plastics and styrofoam and certain packaging material never degrade. They never rot. They never go back to the earth. When we make daily choices about consumption, we're making choices about the environment, about how to treat the world in which we live each day. And when we make our choices, we follow the firstborn of all creation, who calls us to peace and justice and love for people and the planet. As participants in this covenant God has made with all creation, we are called to let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, and that justice and righteousness extend to every living thing. Psalm 85 reminds us, faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky. The Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. But even as we are careful to remember our reusable grocery bags and say no to straws and plastic forks, there's another side to this covenant. Even as we are rooted in the land, this covenant that God makes with all creation creates something in us, a deep and abiding sense of wonder, of awe, of gratitude for the transcendent glory of God. It is for and of that glory that creation is singing in Psalm 148. Praise God from the heavens and the heights, from the mountaintops and valleys, in the fields and backyards and deserts and prairies. The earth, the land, is the Lord's, and all that is in it. So we keep our feet on the ground, but we do not forget to lift our eyes to the stars, to the hills, to the skies. The promise of the rainbow draws our eyes to look upward, to listen intently for God's voice. When God placed that bow in the sky, every living thing gazed upward into the clouds. The eagles in their flight tipped their wings and turned lazily on the breeze. The lion lifted its mighty head into the light of the sun. The hippopotamus raised her ponderous body from the river and shook, spraying shining drops of water in an echo of the rainbow overhead. Spiders stopped their busy spinning, still and silent as the dew on shimmering webs. Turtles turned slowly in the sand, extending their leathery necks toward the sky. Maple trees turned their leaves sunward. Rivers reflected the radiant colors. The human beings, most of all, took notice. Every living thing was watching, for God was moving across the face of the earth. God promised them, when the bow is in the clouds, I will remember it and see it and remember the everlasting covenant between me and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. When God placed the bow in the sky, God hung up a weapon of war and turned it into a symbol of peace and promise. And every living thing took notice. The arc of that rainbow reaches across centuries, across species, across the world, sheltering us in beauty, calling us to mercy, calling us to care, calling us to justice and love for the land and for every living thing.